Please share this widely. This is a couple of years of very deep research to give you a short summary. How Christianity Came to Be, by me, Liam Scheff. You can understand how Christianity came to be by studying history. The Hebrew tribes first fought local tribes for dominance. The Hebrews had different gods and goddesses, El and Yahweh, or YHWH, and Ashera, the goddess, among others. Their land and their leadership was taken over again and again by foreign powers. Under attack, the Hebrew tribes combined their gods, El and Yahweh, killed Ashera, and became hardened monotheists. The Babylonians, or Persians, grabbed the land, and the Hebrews were powerfully influenced by Persian stories of a great flood, a creation myth, heroes in baskets, the code of Hammurabi, the law, and by a wealthy priestly class in Babylon. When the Jews returned home, they brought this mythology with them and turned it into the Torah, Adam, Noah, Moses, and Leviticus. Then the Greeks took over from the Persians and influenced Jewish thinking with the big picture philosophy of Plato and Aristotle, bringing them the ideas that the law, Leviticus, was less important than knowing, gnosis, the word, logos, of the spirit of all. Then the Romans took over, and the Jews waited and waited for their new king, priest, to come and overthrow the new rulers. But it didn't happen. The Romans weren't philosophers, they were imperialists. And they kicked Jewish ass into oblivion, burnt Jerusalem, and destroyed all Jewish identity unless it bowed to empire. And when old Jewish leadership was annihilated, the small cults of Greeked Judaism, Gnosis and Logos, crept into the forefront, and these spiritual Jews, who believed in baptism and anointing with oil, Christos, crawled out of the background and took over the conversation. Argumentative preachers, zealots, Essenes, Nazarenes, and other sects of Hebrew spiritualists walked the land, but Rome destroyed Jerusalem and all things Jewish, so Hebrew thought went even further underground, abandoning its cry for a king of might, and exchanging it for the myth of a king of supplication, who renders unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, who offers the other cheek when one is struck in violence. This new David wouldn't be anything like the traditional fables and myths of Hebrew Samsons, Solomons, and strongmen. He'd be a weakling who would die almost willingly to put off what in reality the Romans had already done. The lower classes loved this story of a punished human god, like their beloved Mithras, Horus, Attis, Dionysus, this anointed deity, Christos, one who worshipped Yahweh, Yehoshua, Yeshua, Joshua, and from the Greek into English, Jesus, Christ, the Anointed. The military swelled with soldiers who followed Mithras, Sol Invictus, the conquering sun, the son of the heavens, who stuck up for the downtrodden. And one wily, manipulative, opportunistic emperor decided to recognize the soldier's religion, worship of a sun god, and put the sign of the fish on a flag. Constantine made Christos, Christians, acceptable. And then the bureaucracy moved in and cut, sliced, reformatted, divided, excluded, and made a messy lot of paperwork out of this Hebrew Gnostic tradition. They held council meetings. They waged internal battles that eventually grew into full-scale genocides, Christian against Christian, until they could work out the letter of the law of their new faith in a literal story of a three-part God with a human mother and a creation, life, death, and rebirth story, all increasingly literal from what had been a spiritual beginning. 1800 years later, we're all soaking in the remnants of this battle of cultures, Rome and Jerusalem. Official Stories 2 will cover this in greater depth. Look for it in 2016. In the meantime, please support independent research, philosophy, and journalism by buying Official Stories on Amazon.com.